Houston, the University of Houston, Texas Center for Superconductivity, and the University of St. Thomas Office of Academic Affairs, we welcome you to tonight's event, The Mystery of Matter and the Hunt for the God Particle. The recent announcement of the discovery of the Higgs-like particle at the Large Hadron Collider, the world's largest and most powerful particle accelerator, has generated enormous shockwaves in the press. Some people call it the God Particle. Why such an awesome name? Can it really be the key for unlocking some of the mysteries of the universe? Can it help us understand the origin of mass, for instance? Can it tell us anything about ourselves and our place in the universe? In this talk, Professor Lucio ROSSI, a leading scientist from the European Organization for Nuclear Research, CERN, he and his group discovered this particle, will address the fundamental questions scientists are facing in the pursuit of the most fascinating scientific discovery of the century. Dr. Allan Jacobson, Robert A. Welch Chair of Science, Professor of Chemistry and Chemical Engineering, and Director of Texas Center of Superconductivity at the University of Houston, will introduce Professor ROSSI. Let me turn the program over briefly to Sue Butler, the Associate Director of Public Affairs for the Center of Superconductivity, to welcome our special guest.
For those of you that aren't affiliated with our campus, we are delighted to be able to host this great organization, this wonderful event. We are also honored to host Professor ROSSI during his visit. Some of you may not know that our university system is comprised of four other universities and six multi-institutional campuses across Harris County. We offer degrees in all of these locations in partnerships with the university. Our campus, the University of Houston, is the largest and most comprehensive institution in our system. We were founded in 1927, and we are known as Houston's leading public research university. For anybody that has access to a newspaper, our president's very proud that we're Tier 1 university. Each year we graduate more than 40,700, and we educate more than 40,750 students in more than 300 undergraduate and graduate programs on campus and online. We award around 8,000 degrees annually. We also are the second most ethnically diverse major research institution in the United States, and we're very proud of that. We have over 137 countries represented at any given time on this campus. And we have students from every cultural and ethnic background, and we're very proud of that diversity. To borrow a line from the Crossroads website, and the reason we're so delighted to host this is that we share a common goal, is to offer opportunities for education, making it possible to work with openness, curiosity, and critical judgment at every aspect of reality. And we'll feel it, but we won't be here. Thank you for coming.
Now we'll turn this over to Marcia, our friend, who will moderate and introduce our speakers.
Good evening. Dr. Allan Jacobson, who will introduce Dr. Lucio ROSSI, and Professor Jacobson, he received a BA in chemistry from St. Catharine's College, Oxford, in 1966, and MA and a doctoral degree in chemistry from New College, Oxford, in 1969. He continued at Oxford doing the postdoctoral research in the inorganic chemistry laboratory until 1970, when he was appointed as fellow and tutor in chemistry Cable College and departmental demonstrator in inorganic chemistry. In 1991, he joined the faculty of the University of Houston and is currently director of the Texas Center for Superconductivity and a member of the advisory board of the DOE Energy Frontiers Research Heterophone Center. Dr. Jacobson's research interests are in inorganic solid-state synthesis and in solid-state ionics related to ion transport membranes and fuel cells. He has published over 400 papers and has 47 patents. Thank you, Dr. Jacobson.
Let me begin by saying that the Texas Center for Superconductivity is very pleased to co-host this special event with our friends from the Crossroads Cultural Center in Houston. And it is my great pleasure and indeed honor to introduce Professor Lucio Rossi, our distinguished speaker this evening. And what I will do is just give you a little bit of background about Professor Rossi and some of his accomplishments. He received his PhD in physics from the University of Milan in 1980 with a thesis on plasma physics. He then carried out his research on applied superconductivity for particle accelerators in the physics department of the University of Milan, and he became a professor of experimental physics there in 1992. After early work on the first European superconducting cyclotron in the University of Milan, he was in charge of the construction of the first LHC superconducting magnets as part of a collaboration between the Italian Institute for Nuclear Physics and CERN. As I'm sure everyone knows, the LHC stands for the Large Hadron Collider, which is the world's largest and highest energy particle accelerator. In 2001, he moved to CERN on leave from the University of Milan to lead the industrialization and construction of the main superconducting magnets for the LHC machine. This project is the largest superconducting project ever. It is a huge project. Since 2010, he has been the leader of the high luminosity LHC project, which is aimed at increasing the performance of the existing machine by a factor of 10 in terms of its luminosity. And so that project involves more superconducting work. It involves development of new, very high field magnets, 16 Tesla and above. It involves special superconducting radio frequency cavities and high current superconducting cables. In 2007, he was awarded the IEEE Council of Superconductivity Award for sustained and significant contributions in the field of applied superconductivity. IEEE, by the way, stands for the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, for those of you who are not familiar with it. And in fact, this year, in 2013, he became an IEEE Fellow. And he has been selected as the 2013 IEEE CSC Distinguished Lecturer for Superconductivity. He's authored over 140 publications in international journals and reviews. Now, in addition to all this, all of his technical accomplishments, he's also been very active in public outreach. And in fact, is a founding member of EURESIS, an association for the promotion of scientific culture established in Milan. He frequently gives talks to the general public and at cultural events on science and the relationship between science, technology, certainty, and truth. You can find him on YouTube if you like to go Google him. On a personal note, I wish to just say that I've had the pleasure of knowing Lucio for several years, primarily through our respective participations in the International Superconductivity Industry Summit and the Applied Superconductivity Conference. And so it's a great pleasure for me to present to you this evening Professor Rossi. And he will give his talk, as you can see there, on the mystery of matter and the hunt for the God particle. Please welcome Professor Rossi.
Well, many thanks to Crossroads for the invitation, to Marcel that contacted me. Many thanks really to Sue Butler and to Professor JACOBSON really for this wonderful today that they had in the Texas Center for Superconductivity, really one of the best institutions for superconductivity of the world. We have it here in Houston. Profit of this possibility that you have. And thanks to all of you for coming so numerous. I'm really, really amazed by the interest that this talk can have. And I hope you can withstand for 1 hour my very thick Italian accent. You have to pay a price for such interesting talk, of course. Nothing comes for free, especially in the US. Okay, let's go straight to the question. The mystery of matter and the hunt for God particles. I like this title, which can be a little bit misleading. Nobel Prize Leo Lederman, when he wrote the book, he didn't mean, at least what he said, he didn't mean the God particle, he meant the Goddamn particle. But very widely, because it was 25, 30 years that was we were looking for, but very widely, since professor write the content but not the title is written by professionals, he said, Goddamn particle is not going to sell. God particle is going to sell because somehow, believer or not believer, the word God always comes about the origin. And only are interested about the origin. And in fact, the book sold a lot, and actually this was how the Higgs particle became to be known in the world. So, because you know, that is the point. You see, this is an instrument that is very deep, 100 meters underground. I hope using meter is fine, or 300 feet underground. 100 meters underground that has the claim to go at our origin, to explain the origin of the universe, to explain the origin ultimately of our physical existence. So, let's go to see what that does mean. That's fine? Okay. So, let's start from the question. We always start from the question, which are really the thing that moves our life. When a person has not any more question, he's dead, basically. So, that's why students are so important, for professors are important, not only because with their taxes they pay their wages, but because you put question, and that is very important. So, never stop to put question. As a professor and as a father, I'm very grateful to my student, to my children that has put question all along my life. So the question, why an entity like CERN exists? And we can say to produce certainties. We live in a society where, at least in Europe, but I think also here, people is losing their reference. The old believer looks fading away, the old belief, and people are left without something solid ground, without reference, and you see in the face of the people many times. So, and many times people come to us, scientists as us, at least you, many people believe, okay, science is the only thing that produces reasonable, solid certainty. And to a certain extent it is true. We are there to produce certainty, to produce solid and undoubtable. It means scientific answer to some fundamental question. But we will see what is the path to arrive to this, and you will see that it is not very much different from the path on which we arrive to the certainty that we badly believe in our life, just to continue to live our life. So, what is an accelerator? The human nature, the human can explore nature according to two main lines. One is exploring the infinitely large, the infinitely far away. And this is probably the first route that the mankind selected. Looking at the sky, certainly the man looking at the sky, we are attracted by something. We are attracted by this need to understand. And actually looking at the nature, question arises. Why is this? Why is this? And who I am? Whom I am and why I'm here. And this is certainly the origin of the science. Science has to do with the source of the self-concept. And not for nothing, even if not this was the very beginning of science as a scientific observation, but modern science was not born, real modern science was not born 3,000 years ago when the Babylonians started to look at the skies and so on, but was born, let me say, in Italy, when a person made a particular significant gesture. Galileo Galilei, he took what probably already existing, again, or about lens, the problem, there is rumor that existed already in Italy, already in Holland, it doesn't matter where it existed, he made of this game a scientific instrument. The cannone occhiale, as he was calling, now we call it telescope. Telescope because he made this an instrument, he perfectioned it by wind, and he pointed to the sky. He pointed to the sky to see better the moon and the star, but he got the unexpected. You see, the instrument was kind of an extension of its own conscience, of his own mind, and he got the unexpected. He got what we call now the moon of Jupiter. It seems a little discovery. It was very important at that time, because at that time people were convinced that in the imperials, what was about, the earth was the terrestrial path, was the things were moving, changing, while the imperials nothing moved. The moon of Jupiter were quickly circulating around. He made the discovery in January 1610, of the year 1610. And in fact, it's very nice. How when he made the discovery, there is still the logbook. And the logbook, at the beginning, he was writing in Italian, the vulgar language, as it was called at the time. And then at a certain point, he realized it was so important, he started writing Latin. Because he was a professor, he was a Nobel Prize of the time. So he immediately thought, this is important, needs to be published. So let's switch immediately to the English of the time, Latin. So he immediately switched to Latin, and in fact, he produced an instant book. You think that in 2 months, a book written by him, it was a copy of his, let's say, of each professor of the time in all Europe. Anyway, and in this book, the Sidereus Nuncius, the messenger from the sky, he wrote a very important phrase. I have seen things ever seen before. He realized that thanks to the instrument, his eyes perceived the possibility of a reality never seen before. The idea that not all what we see exists. There are more things that exist than what we see. And the instrument helped us to grasp this reality. So this is the realm of the astronomer, of the astrophysicist, of the cosmology, the infinity realm. More or less in that period, exactly in the period, a little bit later, but exactly in that period where Galileo Galilei was discovering, inventing the telescope and discovering the moon of Jupiter, that we can consider the time, the year of the foundation of the modern science, of the scientific method. Another, there was a discovery of the microscope, also another very important instrument, because this let us to know the reality in the infinitely small. And actually, our accelerator, they are microscopes. They are very strong microscopes. You can imagine, microscope usually is meant to see 1 micrometer, which is 1 meter, take 1 meter, 40 inches, you divide it by 1 million. By 1 million, this is a micrometer, what we call technically micrometer. Micro stands for very small in Greek. Okay. This we cannot see better than this, because we are limited by the light. The light that illuminates me, for which you see me, is kind of a little wavelength. And we cannot see better, shorter than the length of the wave. If the wave is certain length, you cannot see better. 650 years, it exists, there exists microscope, very special, that we call nanoscope, which use a wavelength, a light, which is finer, which is smaller. And thanks to this, we can see smaller. Actually, we see in a nanometer. Nanometer, nano is another Greek word that stands for small, and we use technically in physics to say 1 billionth of a meter. That means we take the meter and we divide it 1 billionth time. And this is the nanometer. It's basically the size of the atom, of the molecules. Since 50 years, we can see the nanometer scale, the molecules, the atom, and so we can manipulate them. So everybody knows that we are dominated by the nanotechnology. Nanotechnology, because as soon as I can see the nanometer, I can manipulate, so I can do the nanotechnology, which are very useful for our life. Texas Center for Superconductivity is basically a nanotechnology center. Manipulates atoms and molecules, a single one, and both are agglomerate, to produce wonderful things like superconductivity. Okay, things, our accelerator, we use particles. You say, particles, nothing to do with light. No. A French scientist, kind of 90 years ago, discovered that each particle behaves like a wave. This seems strange, but it's like this. I will not go on this. Behave like a wave, and for doing the physicist, I put here the relation that gives you the wavelength, sorry for the people who will not grasp, but the wavelength in function of the momentum of the energy. So you can imagine, the idea is this one: more you give energy to a particle, and more its wavelength becomes smaller. It's like to have a finer light. An accelerator, we give energy to the particle, and we generate a light which is finer. How much finer? We can go. You think, we take the nanometer, 1 billionth of a meter, and we divide this nanometer, this very little quantity, by 1 billionth. It's nano-nanometer. Our accelerator is a nano-nanoscope. What we do is nano-nanotechnology. It's really so. It's really so. For physicists and engineers, I put this number. We explore distance and to this relation, which are as fine as this. We call technically atometer. Actually, it's even better. This is just to give you the order of magnitude. Actually, we have explored already 1/20th of this distance. We know that the quark, the elementary constituents of the matter, are single point, are point like up to 1/20th of this one, or 150 zettometer, 10 to minus 21 for physics. I will not bother anymore about equations. Why we do this? To understand where we come from. We know that we come from the Big Bang. We know this by certainty. Don't believe that we come from less time than this. We come, our universe is 14 billion years old. That is certain, and they prove it. Or so recently, Planck experimentally has released this. And it was a long way to come here. And you see, the point is that this is the universe in a scale. Sorry. Okay. This is the universe in the scale. Universe is very big, but it's finite. Since it is finite in time, it is finite also in size. The universe we can have access to. We don't know what exists outside. It's not science what exists outside. It's philosophy. This is the universe which is finite. So the very far end of the universe, the very distant light, this is a very big number. It's the size of the universe. I was told that it's only matched by the public debt of US, but this I don't know. Also, it's not it's a very big public debt. This I was told. I don't know if it's true or not. But we are not yet at the sequestration of the universe. That is. Anyway. This is the universe, and these are the instruments that we use to explore this. We use a telescope, radio telescope, space telescope. And with our microscope, we are here. We are at this point. We have investigated matter, molecule, atom, how it is done, the atom, which is a nucleus, which is not anymore atom, not divisible, but is something which we can divide, nucleus and electron. And the nucleus is composed by proton and neutron, and the neutron is, and the proton is and the neutron are composed by quark. So basically, electron and quark are really the basic brick of the universe. But we go more than here. We are here. This is our atmosphere. You see, we are going toward the Big Bang because we concentrated such an energy that we really investigated energy density that existed after the Big Bang. But just for people, we can read this scale. They can read this scale. We have also to be, on one side we do things very very difficult, on one side you have to be very humble. You see, when we say the Big Bang, how far still we are from the Big Bang. If you look at the number of magnitude, it's still far away, but we are on the track. What is important? And you know, now before to come to this, one of the very interesting things is this one. Our colleague, the scientist of astronomy, the astronomer and the astrophysicist, they look at the far away. But you know, since the speed of the light is finite, more they look far away, more they look in the distance. Because if today you go out in the sky and you look at the nearest star, which is the Proxima Centauri, means the nearest in the constellation of Centaurus. Actually, you cannot see because it's not visible like at night, but doesn't matter. It's 4 light years enough distance. What does it mean? When you see this star, the light emitted was emitted 4.5 years ago. If today we would see the star exploding, it will not explode, it's not a supernova, but if we see the star exploding, we should not say it's exploding, we should say exploded. Exploded. And when they see a galaxy 1 billion years, light years distance, it means that they are observing the galaxy like as it was 1 billion years. And when they see Planck, it's just the big one of the experiments of the space, it's just released now their knowledge, what they discovered in these 3 months. They discovered many things. They are observing the universe approximately 14 billion years ago in the infant universe, exactly like we do. So you see the two disciplines that they are completely far away from the point of view of the space. One looking to infinitely small, our, the other looking to infinitely large. The astrophysics, we are all converging in time, going back to the origin, to the question of the origin. That is the question that really appeals all of us. I always say that anyway, one point. Origin is nice and is very important, but personally, as a person, I'm more concerned about what is my destiny. Because if it is an origin, something originated. But where is going? Is where is going to? It's like to take a train. If it starts in some place, hopefully it's going. Maybe in Italy not. Maybe in Italy you can have traded without destination. But okay, not true. I mean, I think that as a person, the problem of the destiny, of the destination, is as important as the problem of the reason. Whatever it is, really, you see, I try to show you how much has converted our science. We use very different methods, and we converge toward the problem of the origin. So, what we know about particle physics? We have done accelerators since 50 years. We learned a lot. We are bright, of course. So now we have the standard model, which is the superb construction of the last 40 years. We know, basically, we know how the world is done. We know the brick of our building. We know the brick and we know the concrete, the cement, the bond that keeps together the brick. This is the standard model, the super construction of 50 years. Basically, we know that we have done of 12, there are 12 main particles we call brick. Six are the quark, which are very heavy, and six are lepton, which are very very light. The most known is the electron, and the other electron it comes in three flavors, let's say, but in three generations, and then the other are the elusive neutrinos. I don't want to go on this. I want to say that the on one side is very nice, on the other side is to be elementary particle, they are not that small. 12 in our culture, let's say, is the maximum number that we can accept as an elementary number. We would like to have 1 or 3 would be much better, a prime number, 5. Okay, 12, you can see the 12 tribes of Israel, maybe still you can accept this as a basic number, but it's a lot. Then it's not enough, because, you know, these 12 particles, they come each one with its own antiparticle. It's incredible, but antimatter exists. It's not only science fiction. And I will show you that we will use in the hospital. I'm sure that everybody, some of your family has used antimatter in the hospital. I will show you. But this to tell you only how much the frame is complicated. 12 particles, and each one actually with its own antiparticle. And then, to be clear, it's not enough. Then we have also the particle that carry the force. The force is the force, the cement, the glue, is carried by particle. This is the most important particle in some sense. It's the light. It's the light. It's the most important. The point that this one and this guy, which is the gluon, really, because it's the glue, literally, between the quark. So, you know, we don't have very much fantasy. So, the glue, we call it gluon, okay? Photon, photo is light in Greek, so we call photon, and so on, and so on. And, you know, these are without mass. While these two particles, which are boson, all are boson, these are particles with heavy mass. And we don't know this asymmetry. And to explain this asymmetry, and to explain also why this particle have a mass, there is the cornerstone of our construction, which is called Higgs boson. We will come in a moment to this. Because the key point that we explain many things. We know how the world is done, but we don't understand why there are so many particles already said. It looks like a little bit too much to be a real elementary. Second, why so many forces? There are basically 4 forces in nature, gravitation, electromagnetism, and 2 nuclear forces. And especially we do not understand what is mass. You have to understand that mass is a really critical parameter in physics in the world. In fact, every pupil that learns physics in the high school, the teacher says there is time and space, which is kind of a scenery on which the world happened, and then the first property is the mass. It is introduced the mass. Without mass, there is no gravitation. There is nothing, there is not a wall. So really what is the mass we don't know, but also we do not understand if these are all elementary particles, more or less the same size. To us it looks like point size, but
how it is possible that they have such a different mass? There are some particles which have zero mass, like the photon, and there are particles which have very light mass, like the neutrino, and particles very heavy. There are a difference in terms of order of magnitude of 1 million billion times between the lightest and the heaviest. It's something inexplicable. It's like to say that an animal that is heavy, I don't know, 100 tons is like an animal similar to an animal that is heavy one microgram. It cannot be. We do not understand. There is something we do not understand. To answer to this question, there was being done a theory some time ago, that 40 years ago, actually, Professor Rings, another professor, also Professor Braut and Professor Engler, put through a theory which is called the Higgs mechanism. And this theory forecasts also an Higgs particle. Why it's called only Higgs particle, not Braut, Engler, Higgs particle? It's very simple, because the theory has been done by all of three, but only Professor Higgs wrote the first article was refused. It showed that peer review sometime system is not perfect. It was refused, but he wrote it better, and by rewriting, he added a postilla. A postilla said, by the way, this field, if it exists, should produce also a particle. It was the only one writing. He wrote the second writing of the article. It was submitted to another journal. It was accepted. And it was, being the only one having written that there will be also a particle, the particle is called X particle, not X Braut, Engler particle. That's life. I mean, in fact, the other, I speak once with Professor Engler, said, but okay, of course, a quantum field has a particle, by definition. But he did a lot, so the name remained only to Professor X. This is how life goes. But okay, so the point that he made this forecast, and I cannot explain what is the X mechanism, but I try really to summarize you. It's like to have, the idea is this one. There is a Higgs field. You can call it Higgs substance, like the ether. It's not different conceptually. The Higgs substance or Higgs field that fills all the world. All the world is filled. And some particle interacts with this one, and some other particle not. It's exactly like to be in a crowded football field with many people, you know, this American football, you know very well. And you try to pass through. If I run, of course, I'm heavy, I'm not agile, I will bump against one and the other, I will be slowed down by this, by scattering against these people. I will be slowed down. So it looks like that if somebody is pushing me, it looks like that I have an heavy mass, because by pushing, I do not accelerate it very much. If I take one of these young boy, all champions in runner, we are here in the Carl Lewis Center, so the temple of the runner, and if, of course, you are agile, you pass through, boom, very quickly, it looks like that you don't have much. You do not interact with all the people, with all the players which are there. The X mechanism is the same. The idea is there is a substance that fills all uniformly all the space. We call it fields, but we can call it substance. We don't know, isn't it just a name? Substance, and some particle, like the photon, do not interact with this substance, and so they get the maximum light they can have, which is we call speed of the light. Other particles interact a little bit, so they are kind of slowed down by this, so they got a mass. We push and they go fast, but still they got a mass. Some other particles, like the quarks, interact heavily with this field, and so they look like that they get a lot of mass. We push and then we are not able to accelerate. This is the basic mechanism. It's just an analogy, taken with a grain of salt. But it's just an analogy which is not incorrect, let's put it this way. And so the Higgs theory was put through basically 45 years ago. Approximately 35 years ago were discovered the other particle with the mass, the W and Z, at CERN. Professor Rubio did it, he got the Nobel Prize for this. And so the next question was, so the Higgs should be true. And that's why it was done, the LHC. LHC was basically conceived to answer to this basic question, the cornerstone of particle physics, does the Higgs particle, the Higgs field in reality, but the Higgs particle exists. Because if it exists, the Higgs particle, it means that it's true, the Higgs theory, of the field. The point is that many, you know, sometimes we do many good things, and sometimes we become a little bit arrogant. And many people, especially theoretical physicists, at the time, say, we discovered the Higgs particle, and job is done, mission accomplished, we can go home because we have discovered the key of the matter, basically. And we do this, and then, you know, but meanwhile, it took 25 years to build LHC. We have to build a technology that did not exist. LHC is the prototype of itself. So it took a lot of time. This was really a cyclopic adventure. Meanwhile, our colleagues, the astrophysicists, went on. And 25 years ago, they made a big discovery. They made a big discovery that it exists a form of matter that we don't know. We don't know, and we call that matter. But it's nothing to do with the dark side of the force of Star Wars. We call that because we don't know what it is. We don't have a clue. That is the reality. So we call that. So we are very ignorant. We are more ignorant than before, because now we have a big question that we didn't have before. But look at this night. On one side we are ignorant, on one side we can feeling the existence of this. Again, we know something that we cannot grasp, but we know that exists. We have scientific proof. For example, one scientific proof is what is called the lens effect. We know that some star whose light is deviated by something that do not exist. It means that there is a mass there that deviates the ray of the light. And because of this, this was the idea of the dark matter. Then there is other proof, also how the galaxy interacts each other and so on. So we have many proof, but we don't have a clue. What do we call it dark? Dark is only the price to our ignorance. Even worse, 12 years ago, cracked a big news that the fact that the universe is accelerating. Everybody knows that the universe has been born by the Big Bang, and like anything that is exploding, then it gets decelerated. Not because of friction, there's no friction in the space like in the Earth, but simply because the piece of matter, the galaxy, expands, they still attract each other, the gravitational force acts like a spring, pulling each other, so they are slowing down. In fact, the big question is, will the universe at a certain point undergo a big crunch, come back again under the gravitational pull, or will expand together, slowing down more and more? 20 years ago, the question was answered by something unexpected. Astrophysicists discovered that the far universe is accelerating. But what does it mean, accelerating? After explosion, the pieces cannot accelerate. Means that there is an invisible hand that is pushing. Something that is pushing, a force. In a technical world, we say an energy. What is this one? Again, we don't know. Again, we call it dark energy. Dark is simply the symbol of our ignorance, not because it's black. It's simply the sign of having. But you know, his boson cannot, at least his boson in his basic theory, cannot display neither dark matter nor dark energy. But what is interesting is that dark matter and dark energy is 90% of the universe. The ordinary matter is only 5%. You can believe we started to build an accelerator, which cost a lot, it cost a fortune, a big endeavor, a really the best intellect to build this one, and then, meanwhile, we have many people were saying, discover this and physics is finished, almost, of course, never true, but now we know that this boson is paying only this 5%, which is very important, because it's the ordinary matter of which we are done over. It's very important, we need to go to the, but it's paying only this. I will show you that even if moral panic is this one. No, of course, you can say, this is normal. It's what I cite always the phrase of Shakespeare in the Hamlet. There are more things in heaven and earth than in your philosophy or us. So that means there are more things in nature than in our theory. This is the real attitude that the scientist has to have. To be humble, the nature is a little bit bigger than us, than our theory. Although it's incredible our theory can display. And that is a real miracle. And this I tell you that the fact that the real miracle is the fact that now I will show you that probably our accelerator, our instrument conceived to discover the Higgs boson and other things, now can probably shed light on something, the dark matter that was not even conceived when we built the accelerator. Exactly like the telescope of Galileo, our instrument will be able probably not only to show us better what we expected, the Higgs boson, to discover this boson, but we'll be able to shed light also on something we couldn't imagine that existed when we conceived the accelerator. It's not that incredible. Also, our instrument exceeds our expectation. And that is really something great. We hope to explain, to do a further step in the unification of all the forces. There are four forces, but we have already unified many forces. At the end, we are convinced that these forces are kind of a shadow of one unique big forces that at the present, they're separated in four. But in reality, at the very beginning of the universe, it existed only one force. And we are on the track on this. And LHC will probably explain this thanks to this theory, supersymmetry, that I will comment later. Still remain one step to unify quantum mechanics, also, that means all these forces, with gravitation. This will be very difficult, but this is for the next generation. It's for you, young guys. So what are our methods to do the discovery? What is our method that we use to discover this volume? We accelerate and we collide particles. Hey, my moment, you can tell me, but you just told us that there is a limit at the speed of the light when we discuss with the speed we can accelerate. And it's true, speed of the light comes as an invalicable wall, a wall that we cannot pass. And even in the neutrino that maybe you heard 2 years ago that we are supposed to be faster than light, actually they go to light. Of course, everybody was joking, you know, said, but Swiss, come on, in Italy nothing comes earlier than expected, so this cannot be possible. This cannot be possible. Apart from this, really, speed of the light is invalicable wall. What does it mean? That in reality, when we are near the speed of the light, we cannot accelerate anymore. Because accelerate, I remind you, some physics that are here means to increase the speed in a certain time. And if we arrive at the speed of the light, we never attain in reality. But we are infinitely near. So we cannot accelerate. So what we do to our particle? And if you pass me the example, our accelerator is like to take a very small car, think to the smaller car, probably the Italian 500, Fiat 500, very small compact car. Very compact car. We take the car and we accelerate. More and more, you give gas, more and more, and it reaches the speed of the light. Pardon me, professor, the wrong thing. We don't ever reach, I repeat, but let me pass this. We reach the speed of the light. We reach the speed of the light, and at this point, we give still gas with the motor. What's happening? Go back to Einstein again, always in, we increase mass. We're giving energy, we increase mass. So our little car becomes a truck, becomes a huge car, and becomes a train full of truck. It's like this. You can imagine our proton, because proton is what we accelerate, as I will show, increase the mass 7,000 times. It's like to take a person with his weight, I don't know, 50 kilos and become 35,000 kilos. But I don't know how to translate. Okay, you then multiply by 2 and you have pounds, roughly speaking. So basically, the car has become this train full of big truck. Not surprising that when you collide this, pieces fall apart, which are much heavier, because what falls apart is the truck. Is the truck of which the train is full. That means pieces that were much heavier than the original small car that I started with. So that is the mechanism that we do. Basically, we create mass during the accelerator, and we use during the collision to transform this in particle much heavier than the particle I started to accelerate, generating particle that then existed only at the beginning of the Big Bang. And this is the mechanism with which we go back near to the Big Bang. Technically, we can say we create conditions of energy, not even on energy, but of energy density that existed only at the few, technically, 1 picosecond after the Big Bang. Picosecond is 1 millionth of a second. It's a very short time. Anyway, so we concentrate on this, and somehow we generate this finest light I was talking beginning. But you see, to see is not enough the light. If you turn off the light, you don't see me. But even if with the light, if unfortunately among us there were a blind person, this blind person could not see me. So to see, you need the reality, the light, but you need the subject. The subject, the observer. And our observer, our eyes, we call detector. Because they try to detect all the particle, all the radiation that comes out from the collision. And for a technologist like me, one very good news is the fact both accelerator and detector are very difficult objects, very difficult instruments, much more difficult than the telescope Galileo, and they need very high technology, among us, superconductivity, but many others. So really, our job at CERN is the crossing point, like the crossroad, we can say, between very high-level science and very high-level technology. It's the mutual help of one each other. Science calls for technology, and technology helps science by building instruments that give us a better view, a better sight. And in exchange, thanks to science, technology can really progress. This is what we call the virtuous cycle. So, very short, this is how it works. It's one of the things amazing that the fact that CERN builds up on tradition. Usually scientists are considered people that do not like tradition. It's not true. What we want is to put in question. But we like tradition. In fact, CERN model is very nice because we built up on the existing accelerator, one by one, such a way that what it costs is only the marginal cost, the incremental cost, which can be very high, but it's never the total cost. We reuse what we have. To do a step more, we push our feet on the step before, on the stone that helped us for the step before. So to arrive to the LHC, it's all a chain of accelerator that goes up to the LHC. You will see here in this cartoon. So you see particle accelerating, small accelerator, they get accelerated in 7 kilometer accelerator, and finally they're put in orbit in the LHC, and finally they collided. This is the Scott decided Petering. I did this cartoon in 2004. Actually, I am not able to do it, of course. My student did it for this reason. To turn on the things the professor showed are done by some smart students. Okay. And so it was a bet in 2004, we will discover really the answer. Okay. So you see this one, and in fact we have been really rewarded in discovering this. So, and this is the LHC. You see, this is the beauty that exists in Geneva. There are three beauties. Two are natural. One is the Lac Léman, the lake of Geneva. The other is the Mont Blanc, very nice mountain. This is the highest in Europe, very, very nice. It's really, it's kind of his Her Majesty. And the third beauty is not natural, it's artificial. Is the one in the plain of Geneva, here, 100 meters underground. You see this enormous circle, 100, 300 feet underground. This 27 kilometer long tunnel, 17 miles, underground, and full of high technology. Just to give you the size, this is the International Airport of Geneva, this one. This one is the International Airport of Geneva. So just to show the size, and full of high technology, full who has maybe tests for high technology, full of superconducting magnet, very high field, 17 miles of superconducting magnet. I feel each one 15 meters long, weighing 30 metric tons. They're really big animals. 30 metric tons is like a big truck full load, Like a big truck full load. And 1,500 tons of top quality superconducting cable. We store 15 gigajoules, 15,000 megajoules of electrical energy under magnetic form. It seems small, but actually it's a big storage. It corresponds to the production of only 1 second, but production of electricity of 15 nuclear power plant. We are one of the first big use of HTS superconductivity. We use for a particular case, not for the magnet, it's not good enough, but for a particular application which are called current leads or current feed-through, the high-temperature superconductor that have been discovered 25 years ago in this center, which you have to be very proud of. This is one of the most reputable centers in the world for this. The Large Hadron Collider is not only the most powerful instrument ever built to investigate particle properties. You have to understand it's 100 meters underground, and if you see the white circle, is the one that is only 7 kilometers long, 7 kilometers, still 4.5 miles long, which is 40 meters underground, and our LHC is 100 meters underground. So you have to understand, you can see maybe teeny, unfortunately it's a little bit teeny white, even if the gallery, the tunnel, that connect the two tunnels are not plain, they have to pass from minus 40 to minus 100 meters, and each one is long 3.5 kilometers, that means 2.5 miles, each one of these connecting galleries. Big, four huge experimental cavern to allocate the ice, the detector that where we make the collision, they have to see the collision, and because of superconductivity, we need to be cold. Because superconductivity, I cannot discuss about this, but it's a wonderful phenomenon. I hope some of you does bricolage, how to say bricolage, do it yourself, something like this. And so you change a plug. If you have changed a plug in your home, you know that electric wire that bring current in your home, typically you have 10 amps, 20 amps, and basically you have a few amps per square millimeter. With superconductivity, you can pass 1,000 amp per square millimeter, and plus without heating up. You don't need to pay the bill to the electricity agency. But you need to pay a bill, nothing comes for free, there's nothing like a free lunch, as you know very well, and you have to pay the fee, because this happens only at very low temperature. So you need to pay the electric bill for the big fee that goes really down in temperature. How much we go down in temperature? Think a little bit. LAC is, technically we can say, is minus 271 Celsius. I know it's very much used Celsius. I think it's minus 470 Fahrenheit, something like this. Don't know, but okay, we have an absolute measure. We measure temperature from the above the zero absolute. It exists, this is interesting. Temperature, that means energy, has a minimum. It's not a maximum, or the maximum is the universe itself, but it has a minimum. You see how many walls we have in our knowledge. There is a maximum speed, there is a minimum temperature, that means minimum energy we can reach. We can reach, we call zero, we call absolute zero. We are 1.7 degree Celsius above zero, probably kind of 4 degree Fahrenheit above zero. While colder space, the coldest point of the space, is already 2.7 degree above zero. That means probably it's kind of a little bit more than 5 Fahrenheit above zero, 6 Fahrenheit above zero. So just to tell you, we are at temperature which is much colder than outer space. We've seen 2001 A Space Odyssey, when there is the astronaut that lost himself in the cold space and so on. Space is very cold. In LAC we have 40,000 metric tons of material, coldest than coldest space. Imagine how much is difficult technique. And this because we want to use superconductivity. This incredible phenomena for which we can bring thousand and thousand amperes without friction. And so we can make very powerful magnet, but the price to pay is to go cold. And why? The price is to go cold, and so we need to spend some electricity at the plant. So we need to spend 40 megawatts. It's not small. We spend 40 megawatts just to keep cold our magnet. But you see, if we didn't, and it took actually 25 years to develop this superconductive magnet. But if we did not use superconductivity, we must have built a tunnel 100 kilometers long, not 27 kilometers long. 100 kilometers is 60 miles. Yes, a good 60 miles. And so not 70 miles, 60 miles, it costs much more. Plus we would have had an electrical consumption of 900 megawatts. 900 megawatts is a nuclear power station, is the delivery of a nuclear power station. A nuclear power station costs like the LEC. We would have immediately double our cost to have built a nuclear power station, plus the cost of the tunnel 3 times more, plus the cost of the operation of the nuclear power station. Because we would not have sold the energy, we would have used ourselves for our magnet. So what I want to say is that despite this difficulty, really superconductivity is in every technology. As everybody knows, what is really worth is also difficult to get. You have to put energy. But if you put energy, you get to something. And this is where we are. Superconductivity has allowed the LEC. Otherwise, we could never have convinced the politicians to spend so much money for our accelerator. It would have been impossible. And so, in fact, the total cost of the LEC is approximately for a billion. This is, okay, you can read $1 billion, more or less, in units. $1 billion. The machine itself will cost $2.5 billion, a little bit more, actually, 3.5, because I think euro is $1.3, so this you can read, the cost of the machine itself is $3.5 billion. And the good news is because of this, most of the money is not spent in civil engineering, in infrastructure, and so on. It's spent really in high technology, superconducting magnet and cryogenics. This is the good news. So we really improved the technology. And this is the LEC tunnel in 2002, and this was in 2006, already filled with all our magnet. In fact, if you look at the LEC, you Google the LEC, you always find these pictures about the blue tube, which is contained. Actually, you see only the blue tube, which is the outside. Everything is closed, but the magnet is inside, actually. And this is the cryogenic line that feeds, let's say, with helium, our magnet. And this is the beauty. I always show this because otherwise you show the blue tube and nothing inside. Here with the cartoon you see the inside. You see how much is beautiful? This is the reason why I moved from Milano and I went to Geneva to build up this beauty. My professor was always telling me, Lucio, try to build beautiful, because if it is nice, maybe it works also technology. If it is ugly, there's much less chance to work. But this is true. beauty is a good sign. When things is ugly, be careful, probably will not work. If it is nice, it has very much chance to work. There's something to do near the truth. And this, so this is the reason, so you have to imagine this yellow are the particle beam, and this in yellow, these are the particle beam. So you have to imagine the particle beam, one passing this way, the other passing this way. And the magnet, as you see, is double. There actually is two magnets, we call it fact twin magnet. Each magnet is a double magnet, and the one particle, one beam of particle is bent in this way, the other beam is bent in this way, always the same way. And only a few points, there are special magnets that makes the two beams collide exactly where we put our eyes, our detector. So, this is the beautiful, what I said. So there, and this is inside, this tiny craft, you see this orange brown glass here, this tiny crust here is really the part that is superconductor. It's a very thin, you can imagine, there are less than 1 ton of superconductor in a magnet over the 30 tons of total weight. So really this is the precious part. And this is the superconductor itself. This is a cable, you see, with 30 wire, or 30 strand, as we call it. And in this strand, you can imagine, there are, this is 1 millimeter, it's like a wire of 1 millimeter. I don't know how many mils is, 20 mils, 1 millimeter, don't remember. Okay, it's a smaller wire, and it contains 6,000 filament, very, very fine filament of material. You see here an explosion on the picture. Each filament is approximately 6 microns. This is the superconductivity. We produce enough wire from distance between Earth and Moon. We produce 300 kilometers of wire. So almost the distance between Earth and Moon. And this is one of the, together with my blue magnet, is one of the best pictures of the project. Actually, when I was called to Geneva, I was actually working on this magnet. This is the superconductive magnet, these 8 legs, the superconductive magnet of one of the biggest of the 4 eyes. It's called Atlas. It's one of the 4 experiments, and it's the biggest of the experiments. And so you see, there is only this teeny tube that you see at the center. It's only this teeny tube, but it's long 27 kilometers. This is like a building of a 5 floor, a building of 5 floor, and it has a superconductive magnet. Not as powerful as the one of the LHC, its field is out, but it's very huge. So this is the biggest superconductive magnet ever built. So, and what we do this, we do this size, we do the collision to see this. So, when we go back to the question of certainty, this picture has been used very nicely by the for the flyer of this meeting. So what we see is, there is really looking like the needle in the haystack, because you see, we expect to see one is particle over 1,000 billion event. It's very rare, this particle. And we produce a lot of events. And for example, this was still a computer simulation, approximately done around 2006. You see these 4 white traces. These are what we call muon particle, is what remains of possibly of an X particle. So not only we have so many particles, so many traces to look at, is the fact that X particle we cannot see directly. You think the X particle, you know what's happened? All the, you know that there is a, you can call it illness of matter, all matter decays, there is no stable matter, all matter decays. It has a finite, also matter has a lifetime. All matter decays, the X particle decays, technically it's 10 to minus 26 seconds. 10 to minus 26 means 1 billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second. So you take 1 second and you divide 3 times by 1 billion. It's very small, it decays immediately, we cannot see directly. In the case, for example, in two Z particles, the boson I mentioned before. But also these particles decay, they live longer. But they decay in 10 to minus 15 seconds, I say for the physicist. That means 1 millionth of a billionth of a second. There's no way we can see the Z particle really directly. But the Z particle transforms in 4 muons. And this we see 4 muons. This yellow trace straight. So already it's difficult to identify the muons or other particles. And then the muons are the grandchildren of this particle. It's like to try to know who was your grandfather or grandmother by questioning one of you. It's very difficult. So it's already difficult to get the muons. And then to what I want to say that our knowledge is very indirect. It's not true that the most precious knowledge are direct. Sometimes people say, if I don't see with my eyes, I don't believe. Well, We believe that there exists the Higgs particle, but we have never seen one in a direct way. Is the fact that we put all the elements in physics, you do like in your normal life. When you need to arrive to a certainty, you put all the elements together, you have a reasonable explanation, you see if it is verifiable, you do not verify directly because we don't see this boson, but we see phenomena that can be explained only if it was generated by the Higgs boson in a consistent way. And that's why we need to arrive to the certainty, we need so many events. We need to produce so many particles, because being the evidence very much indirect, to be sure, you need to verify, you need to engage with the reality, and you need to verify, exactly like you do in your normal life. I will keep saying, when I married my wife, how did I know that we were right? We had a period of fiancé, we engaged each other, we know each other, and at the end we arrived to the conclusion. It's a joke, but a little bit with the knowledge of physics, a little bit. You measure, and you arrive to a certain certainty. In statistics, it means to arrive to a certainty of 5 sigma. That means to be sure within one part of a million. That means you can be wrong in one part of a million. But, so, two things. The fact that what you see, you have to clean up.